power of God, the power of God. And we can say that, and we do say that, repeatedly, while not understanding or comprehending the power of God. Okay? And I want us to look at that today, the idea of the mind-boggling power of God. Mind-boggling power of the Lord. Because it goes deeper than we can fathom. Galatians is talking about the great power towards us who believe. And that has been becoming more and more real to me. Because God is so deep, I wouldn't think that I have, that this would be so real to me years ago, but indeed it has, but it will always be a growing revelation for us, for you and I, Christian, as to who God is and what he's all about. Talking about the mind-boggling power, and I love this video, I love that graphic. Let it blow your mind. That's an old saying from the, what is it, the 70s? It blew my mind. Father, we thank you for your word. Now help me just speak it. Help us to hear it. All under the same magnificent anointing of the Holy Spirit of God. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, I got a lot of scripture here, and that I will try to move quickly. You all stay with me. And when we talk about the mind-boggling power of God, the first thing I want you to see is there is tremendous power in his word. In his spoken word. Now, we are often thinking, you know, when we think as Christians about in the word of God, indeed, this is the word of God. The Lord spoke this, as far as your Bible is concerned, he spoke that, and he really did. So don't let people tell you, oh, that Bible, da, 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 da. They just need to get a clue. When it comes to the spoken word of God, Hebrews 11, verse 3 says, by faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. God spoke things into existence. Okay, now, this is part of the mind-boggling power of God. This is not Christian mythology. This is plain, simple speech written in the book of Genesis about God bringing things in existence by the sheer power of his word. That's how awesome he is. And I'll give you a few scriptures from the creation story in the book, first chapter of Genesis, where it said, and God said, let there be light. He didn't try to go find a light. He didn't turn on a light. He said, let there be light. And personally, I think he shined. Okay. I think he just lit up the place. If anybody should ever ask you how could there be light, okay, one of the theological questions I've heard down through the years is God made light on the first day, but he didn't make the sun and the moon until the third day. So where did the light come from? How can you answer that? smarty pants, you believe all this Bible stuff. That's a false dilemma, brother. God doesn't need the sun and the moon to make light. He just said, let there be light. And the light showed up. I mean, he shines himself from his radiant person. The power to create is in his words. Okay, now let me not deviate from that. The power to create is in his words. It goes on in verse 9. And God said, let the water under the sky be gathered in one place, and let dry ground appear. And it was so. And can you imagine looking out upon the ocean and watching continents rise out of the depths, and the dry ground appeared? Verse 20. And God said, let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above and across above the earth, across the expanse of the sky. Verse 24, and God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. Again, in all of these aspects of the creation story, and I'm skipping things, just jumping around here. God said, it doesn't talk about how God labored with his hands. He spoke things into existence. And then you have in verse 26, and God says, let us make man in our image and in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and over the livestock, over all the earth, and all the creatures that move along the ground. And I want us to understand that this power, the Lord moves in this mind-boggling power is a power that is sure. When God says something, it's going to happen. When God speaks something that he wants to happen, you can't stop it. He's irresistible. That's one of the things that the brother said. He's irresistible. He's incomprehensible. The Lord says in Isaiah chapter 55, as the rain and snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so my word that goes out of my mouth, there it is, will not return to me empty. It will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. God's word is sure. Has God spoken over your life? I hope so. It has been my privilege to speak over and into the lives of many down through the years, and I hope to continue doing so. The word of God accomplishes what goes out for him. And may the word of the Lord be spoken over everyone. The Lord has laid out things for you in his word for your life, how we are new creations, how we are not to be subject to the old things, how Jesus really does set us free. Free indeed, if we want freedom. The power of his word. And then, moving along, and I hope moving along quickly, there is the mind-boggling, the mind-blowing power of his love. And that part is hard for us, a lot of us, to grasp, because most of us are still struggling with learning how to love. with knowing what love or deep love is. A lot of us have trouble loving ourselves because of the messed up stuff we've been through. A lot of us have trouble loving others. So the depths of the love of God is often an incomprehensible thing to us. But let me give you a scripture that most of you grew up hearing. A bunch of you probably have it memorized. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. To save the world. And that's what the name Jesus, Yeshua, means. The Lord saves. He's a savior. Now I have a son. My boy, he just had his 30th birthday in July. And he's not a little kid anymore. But he's still my son. And don't ask me to give my son to save New York. Okay, y'all just gonna have to read the bad news, see it on the news, what happened to New York. Pastor Bill, if you don't give your son, New York is going up in a mushroom cloud of smoke. Pray for me, y'all. The last time I was in New York, we got a ticket that towed the car. Yeah. We parked the car, put a bunch of quarters in the meter, came back, the car was gone. Please tow me. We had to walk 14 miles that way and then 12 miles that way to get to the impound lot and pay a whole lot of money. You got to come up with all the extra cash you can come up with just to get the car back so we can drive home. Don't ask me to get my son to New York. All right, I'm just having fun, but
it's true.
So you might as well speak. You shouldn't be in front of the church line anyway. Amen. It's the truth. It's the truth. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. I can't imagine. And that's my point in all this. I can't imagine loving the world so much that you would give them your son and say, son, you have to go down there and die for them. And the Spirit of the Lord and the Son said, okay, I'll do it. That this is a power, again, that I find often that is beyond understanding. You know, the depths of the love of God. And it helps us to maybe get a glimpse of how much God loves us, that his love for you is not contingent on how good you have been. Now, be good. Don't be out there messing up. Okay. If you do mess up, it is the goodness of God that will bring correction to your lives. Okay? And again, one of my childhood memories, an analogy from my childhood is what the times that I was messing up and I got a whooping. Uh-huh. It wasn't because my mom stopped liking me, or she stopped hating me, She didn't love me anymore. Okay. I got a whooping because she loved me. Okay, I got correction. We get corrected by the Lord because He loves us. You know, and I'm thinking about Jesus dying on the cross. You know, the things that we celebrate every year. We celebrate it throughout the year as we look at the Lord's death and we take communion. But around Easter, we have Easter Sunday and Good Friday before Easter Sunday, where we talk about the Lord's death on the cross. When He was dying on the cross, you know, they had nailed Him up there. First of all, they set Him up with this illegal trial, this kangaroo court, and condemned Him to death, and then took Him out and beat Him up and crucified Him. And as He was hanging on the cross, suffering and dying in great pain, they stood around His enemies who set Him up and said, "Yeah, we've got Him now." They stood around looking up at Him hanging there in agony and mocked Him. That's cold-blooded. That's cold-blooded. And they said things, it's recorded right there in Scripture. They said things like, "Yeah, you said you're the Messiah, you healed others. Let me see you come down off that cross." The Roman soldiers who had the actual physical task of nailing Him to the cross and hanging Him up there, they laughed. They're the ones who beat Him up. They liked His clothes. His robe, you know, and they said, "Hey, this is a nice piece of material. Let's not tear it and divide it among ourselves." So they shot dice for it. They cast lots. They gambled to see who's gonna get it. Okay, I mean, it was just that cold blood. And Jesus hanging there. Said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." So then they divided up His clothes by casting lots. "Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing." Can you imagine being in that spot where they set you up and now they're killing you and laughing and throwing insults at you while you die and you pray from your heart that they be forgiven? That's what I'm talking about when I say love that is beyond understanding. Isn't that deep? They don't know what they do. Forgive them, Lord. So, and I want you to remember the unfathomable power of His love, the mind-boggling power of His love. The next time the enemy tries to condemn you, and he does condemn us, doesn't he? Tells you that you're not worthy. And the truth is, I'm not worthy. Well, I'm going to say, "Oh, yes, I am worthy." No, I'm not worthy. It's about all by His grace. By grace, you have been saved. How many times have you read that in the New Testament? By grace, you have been saved. Grace means favor that you don't deserve. He has made me worthy. The power of His love. And the power of His love has brought forth into our lives the mind-boggling power of His work, of His blood. What is it about blood? Blood is the Lord said, the life is in blood. Blood is the element that the Lord always wanted as a sacrifice. Because there had to be death and payment for sin. Because when it says in Scripture, the wages of sin is death, that has never changed. The wages is, in other words, the payment for sin is death. And it's the grace of God that accepted the blood of a goat or a sheep back during the Old Testament where they sacrificed animals as sin sacrifices. It's the grace of God that accepted the blood of the sheep for the sins of the people, and then the rest of the sheep was given to the priesthood and to eat. Okay? That's the grace of God. But Jesus came to be the Lamb of God. We've heard that term a zillion times. Jesus, the Lamb of God. Lamb of God. What does that mean? That means that he is that perfect sin sacrifice, which was supposed to be an unblemished male lamb. He shed his blood for our sins. That's what John 3:16 means. For God so loved the world that he gave his own son, gave him as a sin sacrifice. It is the power that frees us, the power of his blood. 1 Peter 1:18. For we know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life, handed down to you by your forefathers. Empty way of life. Empty way of life handed down to you by your forefathers. But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. Amen. You have been bought with the precious blood of Christ. Oh, the blood of Jesus that washes white as snow. The blood of Jesus. It says, in Revelation 5:9, as we look at this great scene of heaven and all of the millions and millions gathered around the throne worshiping, it says, and they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men from God, for God, from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Okay, and the part that I don't want you to miss is just one more biblical example. It says, with your blood, you purchased men for God from every nation, every tribe and language and people and nation. Not only did he purchase the people, he purchased us, but he made us to be a kingdom. And priests. Some of the older versions will say a kingdom of, kingdom and priests, or a kingdom of priests. But he took us from being dead in our sins to being able to stand before him in strength and in power and in glory eventually. You know, you're on your way to heaven if you believe, if Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, that you have eternal life, that it has been given to you now. It's by the blood of Jesus, by his blood. And then there's the power of his name. Woo! The power of his name. And when scripture talks about in the name of the Lord, the name of the Lord, that word name refers to God's goodness and God's character. In other words, when I say his character, all that he is, his strength, his patience, his power, his holiness, his long suffering, yes, his might, the power of his name. And let me say, the power of his name is the power that is above all others. I'll say that again, the power of his name. His name is the power above all others, and people try to speak against that and speak of God's rivals and what about all the other great religions that's of the world, and that's all they are. Great religions. Oh, Pastor Bill, you can't be talking about other people's religions like that. Okay, you need to start watching all that TV. You've been programmed to be politically correct, and we don't do that here. We proclaim the word of God here. And the word of God says marvelous things. I love how Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, he starts talking about Jesus. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. The name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. What does that mean? And under the earth. What's that? Is it underground? Whose knees are bowing underground? Why does that make sense? That's talking about hell, people. All of heaven bows and says, Jesus is Lord. Everyone on earth will bow the knee and confess with their tongues that Jesus Christ is Lord. And everyone in hell will bow the knee and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You know you're Lord.
Hallelujah.
When heaven, earth, and hell says amen. Amen. And nobody was going to have to make them bow. But the truth of who he is compels them to bow. The truth of who he is makes them unable to do anything else but bow before the Lord. The truth of who he is, when they saw in the scripture, they fell at his feet like a dead man. The truth of who he is beyond comprehension. If you saw Jesus right now, shining in his strength, your first reaction would be to fall on your face.
Amen.
Most people would fall on their face in fear. Absolute terror of him who sits on the throne. You know, it's amazing. You look at all the pictures in scripture that we see upon him, see of the Lord. You know, things come to mind, even as I speak, the things that are not in my notes. This one of the passages that I love so much out in Isaiah, chapter 6, it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And he said, and I saw three living creatures flying before the throne. They had six wings. Two, they covered their faces. With two, they covered their feet, and with two, they flew. And they did not cease crying day and night. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory.
Amen.
glimpse of the name that is above every name, the majesty that he dwells in, the respect that the name commands. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You see, folks, it's all about Jesus. That's why in this godless, politically correct world, even our American culture, they don't want you to speak the name of God. They can say, you can talk about God, but don't talk about Jesus. Politically correct prayers, they pray in the name of God. They sound very pious. Oh Lord, in the name of God we pray. They don't want you to use the name Jesus. Because that's the name that's above everything. Because it's all about Jesus, and they don't want that. Some of them want to be about Allah and the Prophet Muhammad. Muhammad's still in his grave. Jesus rose through his grave. Okay? Muhammad didn't do any miracles. He didn't. Nary a one. Or as the old folks say, nary one. Muhammad ain't the near miracle. Don't tell anybody I said that. But let me help you thinking here. Jesus didn't do miracles either. I say he didn't do miracles. Because I'm not going to call them miracles. I'm going to call them demonstrations of authority. Demonstrations of authority. Okay? Jesus is not just some magician. Hocus pocus. Ding. None of that foolishness. He was showing the power of who he was, demonstrating his authority. When he raised Lazarus from the dead, who had been dead 3 days and stinking in the tomb, he said, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, the dead man woke up, came out. I came walking out of the tomb. Everybody freaked out. When Jesus calmed the storm, come out of there on the sea, they're all in the boat, drowning, trying to bail water out of the boat just as fast as they can, out there in the storm. Jesus in the back of the boat sleeping on a pillow. See, he's just sleeping. Somebody wake him up. Jesus, wake up. And they literally said to him, don't you care that we're dying out here? They literally said that. You can read that in your Bible. Jesus got up and fussed at him a little bit. And up there, faith. You guys. And stepped up and said, and this is where one of the little things that we deal with all the time in our culture, especially our Christian culture. When Jesus said, peace be still. You know, have you ever heard that? Peace be still. They sing song. Peace be still. Peace be still. No. Peace be still. It was two commands. He was exercising his authority. He said to the wind that was blowing like crazy, he said, peace. And he stopped blowing. Threw down the water and splashed up all in the boats. My pants just splashed Bible says, this is the part I love. And the water became as smooth as glass. Okay. And Jesus spoke to the calm, spoke to the storm, to the sea, and brought the calm. With two authoritative commands, two demonstrations of authority. And again, the cool part is that the end of that chapter is after the storm was over and the water was as smooth as glass, the rest of the disciples sat in the boat, terrified. It says that they were terrified. Okay, they looked at Jesus, they were looking at Jesus like this. They were getting this revelation, and they asked the question, who is this guy? Who is this? That even the winds and the waves obey him. His authority. And it goes on and on and on in his demonstrations of authority. Changing water into wine at the wedding feast of Cana, his authority over the laws of physics changes water into wine. Walking on the water, raising Lazarus from the dead, miracle after miracle, healing the blind man, power over death and disease, and cleansing the lepers. Don't think for a minute that he doesn't have authority over the things you struggle with. That's why you can take your prayers to the Lord. Okay. See, Jesus did demonstrations of authority to back up his words of authority. Because he spoke authoritatively, and he still does. Jesus speaks authoritatively, and you can believe it. You can take it to the bank. People who don't know him, well, we just got to give them that much. They don't know it. They can't expound upon and believe what they don't know. Let them come to know him through your life. Jesus is the Word. It's all about Jesus. And I want to wrap this up by saying that Jesus is the Word. You know, we talked about the power of his Word. Jesus is that aspect of God. And Jesus is God, you all. You know that, don't you?
Yes, amen.
Okay. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. I've taught about it periodically, and I may have to do it again. The idea of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three in one. Jesus is the Word. And one quick biblical example is you have in Revelation chapter 19, where it talks about, it gives us this picture of the conquering Christ who returns to set up his kingdom on earth. He comes back as the conquering Christ. It says his eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood. And his name is the Word of God. Jesus is the Word. It's all about him. As we talk about the power of God, the power of his Word, we talk about the power of his love and the power of his name. It's all about him. He is the face of God that is shown to us. He is the love, Jesus. That's why he talks to our hearts and beckons men towards him. Jesus is the love. Jesus shed the blood. That's why he is worthy. And Jesus is the name that is above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. I don't care what God they may, quote unquote, so-called God they may worship on this planet. Only Jesus, only our God is God. And that is the truth. And remember, there cannot be many truths here. This truth is absolute. Truth by nature excludes the things that aren't true. Jesus is his name. Let me tell you about this name. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Isn't that wonderful? Everyone who calls, again, let's go back to the definition of this, the idea of the name. Everyone who calls upon the goodness of the Lord, the character of the Lord, the strength of the Lord, the love of the Lord, all of these things are wrapped up in his name, and in the name means in who he is. Everyone who calls on who Jesus is will be saved. Have you called on that name for the salvation of your soul? This is the only way you can get to heaven. You can't be good enough. I'll be good though. Because your actions prove what you believe. You can't just be a nice person. I think I deserve to go to heaven because I don't wrong people. And I don't cheat on my income tax. Okay, and people, you know, they start making up ideas about why they should go to heaven. Why they think they have salvation. But Acts chapter 4 says salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Get that. No other way to get to people other than by Jesus himself. And again, I hate how political correctness infects our culture. And we as a part of this American culture, we're sitting here in church, but political correctness affects us too. And many of us cringe a little bit when we say, oh, there's only one way to get to heaven. Yes, there is. That's not politically correct. And I know the Hindu priests out there on 7 Mile would be offended. Okay? They'll be offended. I know if we had the Muslim imams sitting here, they would get up and walk out. They're offended. And we love them. I love you. Bye. We love you, but the truth is the truth. I'm not running for a political office, so I'm not going to worry about being politically correct. I'm all about preaching the truth that is in the Word of God, for there is no name under heaven given unto men by which we must be saved. So, have you called on that name? You know, I trust that you have, but I'm not going to make any assumptions. I'm going to just ask the question. Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Have you believed on his name? And made him the Lord of your life? Now, Jesus told us, the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28, just before he ascended into heaven. He said, go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And know that I'm with you always, even until the end of the age. But I quote that to you because Jesus told me as a discipler, you as a discipler, to teach them to obey everything I've commanded you. And that's a part of what it means to follow the Lord, to walk in obedience to what he has commanded us. I just want to give you a practical example of what it means to believe. It's not just an intellectual assent. Because what you believe, you will act upon. Okay? What you do proves what you believe. As we used to say when we were kids, talk is cheap and action is deep. You all remember that? Mm-hmm. Okay, some of you don't. Out there wolfing in the street. Talk is cheap. But let me tell you what is even deeper. The love of God. The power of his name. The power of his blood. All these things are deeper. Pray with me. Father, we thank you so much for this time. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your goodness and your grace and mercy. Lord, thank you for the mind-boggling power of who you are and how you lavish your love upon us. How you show us tremendous grace. We thank you, oh God. Now, Lord, we ask that you help us to walk in these things. Help us to always be aware, Lord, of the power of your word in us, in the little book we carry called the Bible. Help us to always be open and responding to the great love with which you love us. Help us to call upon the great name that is above every name at all times. For we claim you, O God. And we thank you for the great power that is in your blood. Father, now, right now, if there are those here among us who have not submitted their lives to Jesus, forgive them for their sins. Come into their lives and make them make them your own. Be the Lord of their lives, O God. Show your salvation to us. Save souls here this morning. We believe that you, the Lord, that you died on the cross and rose again on the third day, that there is none like you, that you're coming again. Help us to live for you. And we pray again on all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.